Hi, I'm Ford Hallam, and you're watching my Japanese Metalwork channel. This is episode 6A of the Ginko Inlay class. This particular episode was lost to the ether when my hard drive crashed, so we're reforming this. So if you notice any little inconsistencies with the previous and the following films, that's why. But anyway, we shall try and cover what we did in the first film. It obviously won't be as cool as the first time around, but here we go. This episode is about raising the lip that will hold the mongane, the ginkgo leaf, in place. I think it's helpful to think of metal inlay of this type as setting the inlay rather than creating a cavity and then forcing the metal in. So I think that's a misunderstanding that's often bedevils people's attempts at inlay. So I'm going to demonstrate the basic principle using plasticine and a larger model. Right, so what we have here is a little wooden model to simulate the ginkgo leaf. And the first thing you'll notice is the bevel on the sides. That, of course, is what allows us to lock the piece into the metal, a bit like a dovetail joint in woodwork. So I just want to demonstrate the part of the inlay process here. So we place the leaf onto the metal, in this case plasticine, and we scribe a line alongside the metal and lift the piece away. Now what I like to do is just do one part of the piece, and I'll demonstrate this more carefully when we get to the metal in a moment. So I'm just doing that little line and it matches that curve. What I have to do now is take a V chisel and engrave a little V cut just on the inside of this scribed line, leaving a little bit of a lip. So now we have our scribed line, which describes the shape we want to inlay. The next step is to engrave a little V line just inside that scribed line. Now the distance is a matter of judgment. So we're just going to give it about a millimeter in this case because it's upscaled. A chisel's not going to work in this, so I'm just going to use this little piece of brass that I've bent into a V to simulate a V cut alongside it. It's easier to use a chisel than plow plasticine. So there we have our V groove engraved. I've slanted it off one side, really. That was not deliberate. So you'd normally make a just an even balanced V cut. And now what you want to do is this bit of metal that is between the cut and the scribe line, we need to push up to create a lip. Now, the tool we use is a little bit like the back of a spoon. Obviously this is round, but so you have to be a little flatter. So a little flatter at the bottom perhaps, like a little shovel with a bit of a curve. And the idea is you come in from the side and you push up until the side wall is vertical. And you can see what I'm doing there. I hope you can see what I'm doing. And so it's lifting this metal. Because it's quite sticky, it's sticking to me. But if we imagine we're working around with a punch that has this shape, this soft curve, we can work the metal and push it back to the line. What I like to do is actually look along the line, push it, and I can see when it comes into line over here. So I use the scribe line further down as my guide. And so there, I hope you can see how we raise up with the tool like that, the inside of our cavity. So that is preparing the lip. Inside is vertical here, and we've got this excess metal. So once we then remove this metal, we can pop this back in. It sits in the hole. And the metal can be worked down. Right, now let's move on to working with the metal again. So this is the copper textured plate, ever so slightly given a curve, so that the metal looks a little bit more full and interesting. The edge is raised, got a little texture on it. This is the Ginko leaf in Shibuichi, upside down, and you can see it's got a corresponding degree of curvature to sit on this curved surface. So at this point, you need to decide where it's going. I'm just going to leave it there. And you can see it's not absolutely true to the surface. So I've positioned the Ginko leaf in the center, so there's a good border all the way around. We don't want any problems trying to inlay too close to the edge. It's an exercise after all. So the first thing to do and to notice is that the Ginko leaf doesn't fit exactly the curvature of the copper. It's important that they match quite closely. So I'm going to just very carefully and lightly draw around where the leaf is. It doesn't have to be super accurate, just enough marks so that I can position it again in the same place. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a lead block on top of the Ginko leaf and give it a bit of a thump with a hammer just to settle it on the copper. Pencil is quite helpful there to help me reposition it. It does slip around a bit, but I think that should be okay. It's not touching exactly everywhere, but remember we are going to make a cavity for it to sink into, and when we finally do lock it in, we'll use steel punches on the surface and it'll properly bed and marry the two surfaces together. So that'll do for now. And now we're going to start raising a lip. What I like to do is raise one part of the lip, and in this case I'm going to use this curve here, raise that, and then I've got something to lock the mongane, the Ginko leaf, up against. So I can hold it tightly against that while I then draw the other sides. So I'm going to just scribe this curve, but also a little bit around the corner, so I know where the line will go to afterwards. So I'm starting just around the corner, a little bit, there, and then, it moved a little bit. I used to super glue these things in place, but it became such a faff getting that glue off and moving the piece afterwards that I developed this technique. So I've got my first line there. And now we're going to use the V-chisel to engrave a little line alongside that. Right, so I'm going to engrave a little V-line just a little way off the engraved line. It's hard to say how far away from the line you need to be. A lot of that's got to do with how skillful you are. What I tend to do is use the shoulder of the V-chisel as my guide. So the tip is in the metal, and then the side of the V-chisel is running alongside the scribe line. That seems to work for me. So I've engraved the line round. I'm now going to use the lip raising tool, the ari-tagane, to push up that lip. And this is a pretty standard basic ari-tagane chisel. It looks like a safety chisel or something, but if you notice that there's a curve on one side and the face is slightly curved. And so the idea is the back fits in the V, and this front, this triangle face, we try to get it vertical and push up a little lip. So we're going to work around here and see if we can affect the lip we need. Now I sometimes use the corner. So I'm using the corner closest to you first to get started. And you can see the metal raise. I hope you can see the metal raise. Really important to stay in the bottom of the groove. I'm turning it, hopefully you can see what I'm doing. You see a slip there, came out of the groove. So it's very important that you keep a purchase. So it's wise to come along having done a section. Now I've got a good purchase from which to work off. And also, as I said when we were playing with the plasticine, this ridge, the top of this ridge now, lines up with that scribe line. So as I'm pushing this lip up, I'm using the scribe line that's ahead to give me an indication of how far I need to push it. More than anything, I suppose, it's a matter of feeling the metal. Feeling the tool in the bottom of that groove. And taking your time. You do this very gradually, and you can ensure that you get a really nice, neat fit. And, as important, a nice, neat, smooth groove. Now, this is a nice gentle curve, so this tool works very nicely, but when we move on to the wiggly bits on the tip of the ginkgo leaf and the tail, we're obviously going to have to use a slightly different aritagane. As I'm having to work like a blind man here, yeah? Using my sense of touch more than my eyes. All right, let's see if the ginkgo fits up against this now. So here we go. And I think that is pretty tight. So I'm happy with that. You can see, I hope, the little lip raised here. This is very tight and very fine. But I suppose I've had a lot of experience and practice doing it and demonstrating it. Don't put yourself under so much pressure. Feel free to engrave your line a little further away from the scribe line. And so you've got more of a lip to push up. You can always push it down later and chisel away any excess if you need to. And we'll cover that, of course, in the films that follow. Right, so I'm going to put this in position, secure it, and then draw the next bit of the line. Come up here at the top, the ginkgo, wavy ginkgo line. So right, I'm going to scribe this little wavy bit up to the tip and in here. Right, so let me engrave that. Now, the bottom of this little V here, where the leaf goes in, we don't want too much metal raised up here as in form of a lip, because that'll be really awkward to push down and clear out later. So I'm going to come quite close to the line here, and make sure it's just a minimum amount of metal, just to seal the metal rather than to rely on this as a locking area. There'll be more than enough on the other areas to hold it all in place. So what I'm doing is I'm making sure that later, when I do need to tidy up the outside, I'm not making problems for myself. So this is something to think about when you are inlaying. You've got to think ahead, make your life a little easier and your job a little neater, a little bit of forward planning. And I'm doing this V before we move on so that the piece can be more securely located. All right, so I think that's about far enough. All right, now I'm going to use a slightly smaller aritagane to do these wavy lines and around the bottom here. So now I'm using a slightly modified aritagane. This is more rounded. In fact, it looks very much like a gouge chisel, but for the fact that the face is rounded and the sides are softened and the tip isn't quite so sharp. But you can see how, like a little finger or the back of a spoon, I can use this now to push these curved edges up more readily than with a straighter one. So let's do that. And so I pick it up, move it around. Okay. It's important to remember, not only are you raising a lip, you're also pushing into the ground because you obviously need some depth into the ground. When you set your mongane, it's no good just having a lip to hold it in because you're going to press that lip down level with this ground. So it's only the metal that's taken away below the overall surface that's really ultimately the final sort of bed for the inlay piece. So remember that the bit you raise up is going to be flattened, so there better be some depth below that to receive the actual inlay piece. Now, I've got to the end here. This tool is too big to get in there, so getting to the corner there, rounded aritagane isn't really going to fit in there, so now we revert to using these much narrower ones, which are shaped like little horse hooves. There's a bit of clearance on the back. To be honest with you, I've never really needed that, but perhaps it's just a way to make the tip more delicate. It was explained to me that it would help you work around inlay if there was raised inlay, but frankly, I've never needed this shape, but it looks cute anyway. So we're gonna use these to get into this tight corner. Over here. I'll start with the larger one and see how we get on. These little areas, you have to be very careful with because it's very easy to open them up too much. And then sometimes you have too much metal to push back and you end up with a little baggy fit. And there's nothing quite as embarrassing as a baggy fit. On your metalwork. All right, so let's see how that fits now. Bring that in there. Yeah, that's nice and snug. There we go, nice and comfy. So let's go back to the other side. Now we've got this relatively flat sweep, so we'll go back to the original aritagane. As I said, coming around here, I want to be very careful. I'm going to use a smaller one, just so I can have a little bit more control. Just raising a little bit. Just a little bit. As I said, this is just to seal the gap. I'm not relying on this little indented area to make any serious locking. And incidentally, you see those little crenellations there, reminiscent of little ants. Ari means ant. So, aritagane, ant punches, or as I like to call them, ant pushers. Imagine shoving the ants around. It's going to come on the other side. Working completely in the dark, using spidey senses. Right, so that's that. Pop the ginkgo leaf back on and see how we're doing. This is really important. You're double checking as you go. It's really helpful that way, and you can avoid any massive errors. I think we're okay there. Probably take out a little bit more here. So I'm just going to push that up a little bit more. So the idea is, if you do it as you go along, you don't get to a point where everything's too loose. You can't be going back and forth. I've done this part, I don't want to come back to it. I want to treat this as a fixed thing. All right, that's that. See, I'm using the corner of the punch again, just to get in where I need to. I think that's okay. Pop it in. Yeah. I'm also mindful of that, when I use the safety edge chisel in a moment to clear away the metal inside the raised lip, I am going to push inevitably a little bit on the lip, and so it'll move it a little bit. So I can afford at this stage to have it pretty tight. Okay. Let's go back to the tail end now. This is nice and secure. So I'm just going to draw from the tail up to here. Actually, as it's so secure, I'm going to do all of this now. Oh, don't do that. I hope you can see the advantage of having the lip done in sections. Now, this is all locked in place really rather tightly up against the raised lip. There we go. So those lines are nice and clear. So I'm going back to my little V chisel, and I'm going to come in from the tail end. Now, this is really quite close here. It's very narrow. The example that we did previously, this being the second filming, was slightly wider. And so there were two tram lines. This is going to be really rather close. If it was very, very narrow, this channel, you can in fact just use the original line and just push the other side as well, as if you were doing wire inlay. But I think we can make a separate line here. So I'm going to start here, just within the stem. Now, I'm not going to go all the way. It's not necessary, because the other side of the leaf is exactly the same. So I'm just going to do the tail end because that we haven't done yet. And I'm going to leave this area. Work in progress. I'll find it one day and wonder why it's not finished. Coming around to finish up the tail. There we have it. Now I'm going to take the relevant aritagane, work around the tail and out here, and make sure the leaf fits. Okay, and use the little ones right down in the bottom here. I think, as I've said before, when doing inlay work, it's the extremities, these very tips, the end of the leaf, those really are really very important to get really nice and deep and well secured, because that's where your inlay can pop out if you don't really get that right. So pay particular attention to these little outlier points, particularly if it's the thin things at the tips of leaves or grasses and so forth, tip of a bird's beak. It is tricky because it comes to a point which is a natural focus, and if you've mushed it up or got a gap there, it makes for a slightly embarrassing mess. So I want to check the tail. Yep. Let's swing that round. You can see it fits pretty tidy. Probably a little bit more gap there than I would have liked. But once that's inlaid, if I work this with a punch here, that metal will spread and I can fill that gap if there is a gap there later. Okay. So now I'm going to move around and just raise the lip along here. So just to reiterate, this is the edge that's pushing, and I really want this wall to stay relatively vertical, and the back of the tool, this bit, is riding on the back of the V groove. So as it slides in, slides down, this face, being vertical, pushes the other sloping side up, and that's of course what creates the little lip. I suppose that the real difficulty here is knowing how much to raise up and how deep to go. But really, that's a factor of the metal you're using, how accurate you're able to work. There's no hard and fast rule, and I can't give you an exact answer. So let's see if this all fits. What I want to feel is that it's locked in place and it's not wobbling around. So it's held by the lip. Indeed, that's it. So, one last thing to do. Just pretend that bit's done. We now use a safety edge chisel, the shishai bori chisel, which if you've made one and used it a little bit now, you're probably ever so grateful that I introduced you to it. I think I did say it would become one of your favorite chisels. No, I just have to find one. All right, now I'm going to use the safety edge chisel to pare away a bit of the metal alongside, on the inside of the lip. This is in preparation for the following step, which would be to excavate all of the metal. So we do this first to get away from the raised lip, because the raised lip is quite delicate. The safety edge chisel, if you remember, only cuts on the leading edge, the edges, the sides rather, being rounded, so they can run relatively safely up against something without cutting it. So let's do that. This is probably the easiest part of the job, certainly the most satisfying. And again, I like to do a little bit, get it to the correct depth, and only then move on. I don't like to have to go back and forth. I don't know what that says about me, but... So you can see how I'm able to get right up against the edge without damaging it. And again, you know, I make a lot of, you know, I make the point that it is really important to make your tools accurately. And it's not because I'm obsessed with mechanics and precision and exactitude. It's because I know I won't be able to inlay the delicate flowers and leaves I need to if my chisels aren't precise. Having the precise tools I need means I can do the delicate, sensitive work I want to do. So I'm stopping there. So we see that nice sweep. That's quite satisfying. Now I'm going to tackle this little wavy bit. Try to do it in little sections that make sense. Like I said, do one bit nice and neat and then move on to the next bit. And you've got a guide, haven't you? And what I'm aiming to do is remove all trace of the bottom of the punch marks. I don't want a little channel at the bottom. That's got to be the corner of my inlay pocket later. A little bit of a burr caught there. And get rid of that. So I'm really aiming for a nice, clean, sharp bottom of this groove. I'll get to a point in a minute where this chisel will be perhaps too big. Coming around. Be very careful in these little delicate areas. Pivot on a corner. Right. Let's go back here. Start the stem up here. At this point, you have to be careful not to catch the other side of the stem's channel. So I'm going to go back to the thicker part down here. I'm watching both sides very carefully so as not to catch. I'm going quite a high chamfer here, just to get out the excess. On the bottom. You could, if you've got one, use a smaller safety edge chisel at this point. I suppose I'm just demonstrating the basic technique now. Just clearing out. And obviously when you're flicking things out, you've got to be careful not to mess up that lovely texture you've created. You'll just create more work for yourself later. So I'm going to sweep down here as well. And I think that's us done. Right. So that's that. That's your lip raised and the inner edge cleaned up. The ginkgo leaf now should sit nice and snug in there. Yep. Obviously it's not going to seep down because we haven't excavated the ground in between, and nor is this side got a lip. But there we have it. That's basically raising your lip and preparing it for the ground to be excavated, which we will do in the following part, which already exists. So there it is. I hope that helped. See you next time.